Good evening, my name is Rick Clear. I'm the Dean of the Faculty of Arts here at the University of Regina. I'm delighted to welcome all of you here tonight to hear Dr. Gwynne Dyer speak about an issue that I'm sure weighs on all of our minds. I'm told we'll also get bonus coverage of a certain recent election. Dr. Dyer started off as a traditional academic. He earned his PhD in military and Middle Eastern history from the University of London. He held an academic appointment at the Royal Military Academy Sandhurst from 1973-77. But not long afterward, he managed to break away and become an independent scholar, something for which most academics would surely envy him. In 1973, the same year that he started lecturing, he also began writing articles for leading London newspapers about the Arab-Israeli conflict. And after a few years of this, he took the plunge and decided to attempt a career as a full-time journalist. The move worked out for him. For decades now, he's been writing a twice-weekly column on international affairs. That column is published by over 175 papers in some 45 countries. It also appears in many Canadian newspapers, although unfortunately not, I see, in the Regina Leader Post. In the 1980s, he expanded to video journalism. His miniseries, War, aired in 45 countries. One of its 8 episodes was nominated for an Academy Award. His 1994 documentary, The Human Race, won a Gemini Award. He's also the author, of course, of numerous books. 3 of them reached at least 2nd on the Globe and Mail's nonfiction bestseller list. These were Ignorant Armies, Sliding into War in Iraq, 2003, Future Tense, The Coming World Order, 2005, and The Mess They Made, The Middle East After Iraq, 2007. His book, Climate Wars, published in 2009, has been translated into more than a dozen languages. And his newest book, Don't Panic, Islamic State Terror in Today's Middle East, which came out in October of last year, has already been translated into Arabic and Turkish. In 2010, he was made an officer of the Order of Canada. Please join me in welcoming tonight's distinguished speaker, Dr. Gwynne Dyer.
Which is talk about, the Middle East, all that stuff, promises, but I thought some of you might actually want to talk about something else this evening. So we're going to do a somewhat abbreviated version of what I might have done on terrorism to leave some room to talk about the rather extraordinary events that occurred just south of the border earlier this week. And just to give you a little teaser, I was talking to Rick Clear just before we came up and in the car. And he said he wasn't surprised. I wasn't laughing. I went through Brexit in London last June. I knew all the signs before this one started. So we'll talk about that as well, and then of course the usual question and answer. But let me start with terrorism. Which, by the way, when I was making a crust of bread by teaching in military academies, back before I gave up the day job, I used to teach terrorism. Because it was a big subject back then. This was just at the end of the European, wars in the European colonies. All the liberation movements used lots of terrorism. And also it was the heyday of the urban terrorists, the Bader-Meinhof gangs and so on. So I taught terrorism in both the Canadian Forces College in Toronto and Sandhurst in England. And there was a whole body of doctrine. How do you deal with this? How big is it? What's an appropriate response level? And all of that got lost. They stopped teaching it around the 80s. purpose of military careers. They retire after 25 or 30 years on a fat pension and get a second job. I didn't mean that. given the relative brevity of military careers, most of the senior officers, by the time this round of terrorism came around, had escaped the education that I would have given them if they'd been in military academies a little while earlier. So we've had to climb back up the whole learning curve again. And that may explain why we're still doing the job 15 years later. Two things about terrorism, right away. Terrorism is always smaller than it looks. It's designed to look bigger than it is. The whole modus operandi of terrorists who have very limited resources, they don't have heavy weapons as a rule, they don't have thousands of people to dispose of, and they certainly don't have a cash flow like, you know, even millions of dollars a week, let alone the hundreds of millions of dollars your average government disposes of. So they can only do small attacks, but if you do it spectacularly enough, the media will do the rest of the job for you. They will inflate it until it really does look like the biggest event that happened this week. And that will be the transformation that makes a government overreact in ways that somehow or other served the purposes of the terrorists. That's the second thing you have to understand. Terrorism is always about getting a reaction. Generally from a government that is, or indeed an overreaction, that in one way or another serves the terrorists' purposes. They don't do it because they like the noise it makes when the bombs go off. They have political goals, they have strategies, and these strategies all hinge on getting an overreaction from the target government. If they don't have been teaching that in the military academies, a little bit later on, we wouldn't have had two wars after 9/11. But there you go. So let me begin with a little illustration of what I mean by very small input, very large output once the media get their hands on it. An example I thought I would use is Canada. We had two minuscule terrorist attacks 2 years ago. You probably recall, because they did make the headlines. The first was some misguided young man, French-Canadian, in, I think it was Saint-Jean-sur-Richelieu, one of the small towns, around 50 clicks east of Montreal. No evidence he ever went abroad or was in touch with terrorists abroad, but he had converted to Islam, in the sort of experimental way young people sometimes try religions on. And though I don't think there's much of a Muslim community for him to be part of in Saint-Jean-sur-Richelieu. And then he had gone on to various websites and essentially self-radicalized, in the phrase they use these days. That is to say, he found an Islamic State website and that led him onto another one. And of course, the whole purpose of Islamic State's websites is not just to raise consciousness, but eventually to get Muslims living in the West to carry out terrorist attacks. It's very low cost. All you need to do is maintain the website. You never even have direct contact with these people. So he was one of these unfortunates. And in October of 2014, he hadn't much of a plan. October 2014, he was sitting in his car in a supermarket parking lot when two Canadian soldiers came out of the supermarket carrying groceries. They were reservists, they're extra civilians. They'd been doing their training and they were on their way home in uniform. And on the spur of the moment, he kind of planned this. He tramped on the gas and he ran them over several times. Backed up, all that, horrible. Killed one, badly injured the other. Well, of course, the police are called, there's a car chase, he goes off the road, smashes into a tree, not badly hurt, comes out of the car, but his hands are not visible, and the cops have rules about these things. You're chasing a murderer, might be armed, you can't see his hands, shoot. So he goes down, he's dead, you can't ask him what he was up to, but of course they go to his house, they look at his computer, keeps a record of the websites he's been on, all becomes clear. 3 days later, there is another terrorist attack. Completely unrelated so far as anybody's been able to learn. In Ottawa, an English-Canadian guy this time, who did actually have a father who had at some point in his life been a Muslim. He was born in Libya. He came here with his father when he was 3 years old. He did not grow up Muslim, but he did convert to Islam in his later teens. As is often the case with converts, he was attracted to the more extreme brand of the religion. And again, the same process of self-radicalization on the Islamic State and other Islamist extremist websites. And he took a rifle downtown in Ottawa, murdered the young corporal, a reservist, who was guarding the National War Memorial, ran up Parliament Hill into the Houses of Parliament, looking for someone important to kill. And Prime Minister Harper, who was in the building, was stuffed into a closet by his security people, and he wandered around for maybe a minute. These things happen fast, and then the sergeant-at-arms, who had a pistol in his desk drawer, the next serviceman and so on, came out into the hall and blew him away. End of story. That's it. That is Canada's total experience of terrorism since the 19, on home ground since 1960s and the Quebec Liberation Front. Four killed, two innocent Canadians and two guilty Canadians. With respect to everybody concerned, human life is important. In news terms, that's one bad car crash. Four people dead. Icy road, spin out, roll the car three times, four dead. It makes the provincial news, no question about it. It won't even make the national news unless it's a very slow news day. But because this was terrorism, it took over the media for the better part of 2 weeks. Nothing but terrorism. We're all in danger. Do something, government. Who are these people? They're among us now. I can't sleep. Is it safe to go to the supermarkets? You saw what happened to them. And the pressure on Prime Minister Harper, who did eventually come out of the closet, to do something about this, do something, anything, show like you're, you know, taking charge, was so great that he brought in Bill C-51, you recall, which attacked our civil liberties in various rather small and insignificant ways, frankly. The police could hold you a little bit longer and interrogate you before they had to either charge you before a judge or let you go. And I think it was something about Canadians could now be stopped at the airports and not stopped from leaving the country without having to have an explanation given to them about it if they think you're somebody going abroad to get terrorist training. Nothing that really would have addressed either of these events or done anything to prevent them, but Mr. Harper felt he had to make a gesture, something public. Look, we're doing something. We're attacking your civil liberties. That'll make it safer. And Mr. Trudeau says he's going to repeal those bits of the law. I sincerely hope he does, but somebody should hold his feet to the fire on that one. So that's how it works. Now, what did the Islamic State get out of this? Not much, but maybe a little. Two things that it might have benefited from were, first of all, in terms of recruiting young Westerners, young Muslim Westerners, to go and be cannon fodder in their wars in the Middle East, there is a competition underway, particularly between those who still are with Al-Qaeda, Bin Laden's old organization, and the breakaway group called Islamic State, who now tend to have a whip hand. So they're competing for recruits, and one of the ways you show you are fit in the sort of Darwinian sense is by killing Westerners. So it's kind of an advertisement for your ability to do what you want them to do, and they want to do. The other possible benefit from this is, of course, that there is a possibility, I don't think it came to pass in Canada, that these kinds of attacks carried out by people who are Canadian will turn Canadians against their Muslim fellow citizens. And that, of course, is going to cripple the country in various ways. And again, generate more recruits for their cause. It's a low-cost investment. I mean, they're not training people, they're not arming people, they're not buying people airline tickets and sending them here. They just keep the websites up. Well, of course, you know, every website gets taken down a week or two, but you just pop another one up. It's another constant process. And, you know, for that level of investment, you get an adequate return, so they go on doing it. But you see the principle. Very small input, very big output, because the media cannot resist feeding frenzy. We have a saying in the media, if it bleeds, it leads. Sorry, we do. And it's a bit cynical, but it accurately describes the process. What is the lead story of the day? If there's blood involved, it's the lead story of the day. And there's not much you can do about it because people are interested in other people and they're particularly interested in people in trouble. So we can't not cover it. I'm obliged to do this myself. I mean, I'm part of the problem. When this happens, I have to write about it. I don't say perhaps exactly what all the other journalists say about it. I say, you know, calm down, you know, this will go away and it's not that big a deal anyway. But I'm still adding to the mass of material that suggests this is important, because why would everybody be writing about it if they aren't? So it's very hard to prevent this inflation from occurring, even if we know we're helping the terrorists. So that said, who are the terrorists who are attacking us? And what is their strategy more broadly? Well, obviously, they're Muslims. Now, I didn't say Muslims are terrorists, I just said those terrorists are Muslims. That's a very important distinction. If 1.5 billion Muslims were our enemies, we would be in trouble. But they're not, and we aren't. They're actually Arabs, overwhelmingly Arabs, and Arabs are only a quarter of the world's Muslims. All 19 hijackers in 9/11 were Arabs, mostly Saudi Arabians, a few Egyptians. All the people involved in the attacks in France and Belgium last year, in the past year, were Arabs, some born in France and Belgium, some who came there more recently, and most of the people in between in that 15-year span of time, Arabs. This does not come out of the three-quarters of the Muslim world that isn't Arab. No Turks. No Iranians. However much you may dislike the Iranian regime, they're not attacking us. No Indonesians. So on. It's the Arabs, and it is the Arab world that we have to focus on if we want to know where this is coming from, and why, and what might you do about it, and how big a threat is it. And as soon as you look at the Arab world, two things become clear. It's in a dreadful state because it is all dictatorships from one end to the other. There's one exception, which is only about 5 years old, and that's Tunisia. The nonviolent revolution of 2011. Apart from that, the Egyptians did it, but then they threw it away. You know, they're back with a military dictator now. Apart from that, 15 countries, 350 million people, and not a single functional democracy. A couple of countries that pretend to be democracies, like Lebanon, but nothing I would call a serious democracy. which is extraordinary in today's world because democracy is the norm. There's one dictatorship left in the entire Western Hemisphere, Cuba. Venezuela, one may not like the government there, but it's not a democracy, not a dictatorship. One dictatorship left in all of Europe, Belarus. Half of Africa is democratic. Most of Asia is democratic, with one great exception of China. And indeed, the rest of the world is largely democratic. Turkey's democratic, Indonesia's democratic, Bangladesh, Pakistan, even Iran, Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays, is a democratic country. So, the Arab world is a real outlier in terms of its political arrangements, and partly as a result of those political arrangements, it is also the second poorest region of the planet. This is a bit distorted in Western perception because there's a few Arab countries in the far east of the Arab world out in the Arabian Peninsula who are sitting on large amounts of oil, and they are still rich, though not as rich as they used to be because the population's ballooned. But apart from them, the Arab countries are very poor and getting poorer. Living standards have been in decline for about 30 years because the population grows and the economy barely grows at all, if at all. So there's plenty of reasons for Arabs to be cross. Living in dictatorships under the rule of people, either military dictators or royal families who are exploitative, ripping the country off, and rather oppressive. We're not talking about our own dear queen here, you know, waving from balconies and opening nursery schools. No, this is different. And there's a lot of anger in the Arab world, directed at these regimes, initially not at us. And the attempts to overthrow these regimes all began in the latter 1970s. And the peculiarity that makes this an unusual kind of liberation movement, you might call it, is that the dominant ideology of the Arab revolutionaries who have been trying to overthrow these kings and dictators has been what we call Islamism in the West. Now, that's not actually the word that they use in Arabic, but you do hear the word Islam in there, and it leads people to think it is some sort of religious doctrine. It's a revolutionary doctrine. It is not a religion. It draws on a fairly extreme version of Islam for its assumptions about God's will and so on, but it is explicitly a revolutionary doctrine designed for a Muslim audience. And the way it goes is this. What the Islamists would say is that we have been trying to modernize, to raise living standards, to become prosperous, to become powerful enough to deal with Western interventions because the European empires keep coming back, although they allegedly left in the 50s. And so we need to be powerful. We need power, we need prosperity. Oh yeah, and we wouldn't mind some respect after having lived under foreign rule for 1,000 years. So the agenda that they address is an agenda every Arab would agree with. We are sick of being poor, we're sick of being oppressed, and we would like some respect. And the Arab world began, after it got its independence in the 1950s, by attempting to modernize in the Western European style, or the North American style. I mean, we were the first out the gate on that. We built the pathway. And so they tried to do it the way we did. So we build school systems, and we create industry, and we lay the foundations for science and technology, and work real hard, and hey presto, in 1.5 generations, you'll be as rich as the Germans. Well, you know, it didn't happen. And it didn't happen, in my view, basically, because the regimes, to the extent that they were even interested in doing this, were totally incapable of doing it. They were the wrong people to be trying. You know, the king of Morocco, or some young army lieutenant who takes over Libya or Syria or Egypt, is not the kind of person you would have in charge of building school systems and building industry and, you know, creating the basis for a scientific and technologically competent society. So it all failed, and by the 70s it was clear it had failed, and they're looking for, still, power and respect and prosperity. And what his little said to them was, look, the reason we have failed is because God does not want Muslims to copy the infidel West. We have failed because we were barking up entirely the wrong tree. God doesn't want Muslims to copy the European path to power, prosperity, etc. What we have to do, quite differently, we have to make sure that everybody in the country does exactly what we know to be God's will. Literally, everybody obeying all of God's rules. And their version of God's rules is fairly extreme compared to mainstream Islam. They're pretty far out on the extreme edge of the religion list, and every religion's got an extreme edge, as you know. But if we do, if everybody in the country has stopped smoking and stopped drinking alcohol and doesn't listen to music anymore, because God doesn't want us listening to music, it distracts us from our prayers, and if every man has allowed his beard to grow, because God does like beards, but he hasn't trimmed it because God doesn't like beards to be trimmed, and no woman goes out without being covered from head to toe and being accompanied by an adult male relative, and 1,000 other nitpicking details of dress and behavior that apparently God insists on before you get to be rich and powerful, then when everybody is doing that like some enormous nationwide line dance, then God will give us the power and the prosperity. And quite literally, we do not need to build the industry and the nursery schools and the education system and all the rest of it. God will give it that once we are living right. Of course, we still have to have a revolution because you guys got to put us in power so that we can force everybody to live like that. But at least now we've got a program for what we do after we get into power that you might believe will work if you're really devout and kind of stupid. And most Arabs aren't stupid. And this is magical thinking, and although it will appeal to some desperate people, it won't take in most people in the Arab world, and it never has. Even given the desperation and the poverty and oppression that Arabs live in, I would say that there's probably never been a country in the Arab world where the level of belief in this kind of thing went above 20%. Mostly more like down around 15-10%, which is enough to get you started, but it's not enough for the end game. And so what you had in the Arab world was revolutionary. The dominant revolutionary doctrine is this Islamist doctrine. Of course, now we have the problem of getting the message out, because these regimes are not just oppressive in the sense of preventing your actions from defying them. They're also in complete control of all the mass media. So you can't get the message out, here we are, this is what we believe, support us when we want to, when we finally go out in the streets, you'll be with us. How do we get people to know we're here and what our beliefs are? And the answer is terrorism. In a media-controlled environment, one of the only ways you can break through and get public attention is by blowing things up, as many other terrorist groups have also found. But if you blow up a busload of policemen downtown, you will be noticed. They won't be able to pretend you're not there anymore. They will undoubtedly say horrible things about you, but people will know there's a group out there who want to overthrow this dictator, and if they're sufficiently fed up with the dictator, they may at least look into who these people are and what their ideas are, and if you ask around, you can always find somebody who knows. And terrorism has the additional benefit of making the regime go crazy and become far more repressive than it was before. By and large, oppressive regimes don't want to put more energy into beating people up than they absolutely have to. Because it tends, first of all, it takes a lot of manpower, and secondly, it pisses them off. So, if you are a terrorist, your aim is to get the government to behave as badly as possible in order to alienate people from the government. They probably don't love it already, but they'd rather keep their heads down and not be noticed. But you can't keep your head down anymore because we're killing soldiers and policemen and judges and civil servants and politicians, and they're all furious and terrified, and they're desperately looking through the society to figure out who these terrorists are. They don't wear badges, you know. And in the course of doing that, they take their gloves off and people get hurt a lot. You know, we can't find Muhammad. We were sure he was in that that attack last week. His sisters live there, and one is at university in the other city. Let's arrest them and torture them. They probably know. So terrorism radicalizes people by making them angrier at the government because of the way the government is responding. And there you have it again, small number of people attacking governments, doing symbolically big things which are inflated by the media, and even in the, because the governments generally don't, you really should pretend this isn't happening, but it's, you know, they haven't all gone to this military academy either, at least not one I taught it. And, well, actually, I think there were a few at Sanders. And so gradually you begin to build a base of support in the population, which on the great day will come out, and you know, they just can't stand it. You can't live with this government anymore, this regime, and so, yeah, we'll come out, risk our lives, put you in power. That's a theory. 25 years of terrorism in the Arab world, and they didn't get a single success in 15 countries. Blood all over the wall. Between the late 90s and the end of the 20th century, say 22, 23 years, there were so many attacks and so many retaliations, which quite often involved indiscriminate killing of people suspected of being associated with terrorists, that there were about 300,000 Arabs killed. 300,000, that's a small war. Pretty big war, actually. In the struggles between Arab, you know, civilians and a few terrorists and the Arab regimes. There was, I mean, they seized the Grand Mosque in Mecca right at the start with a couple of hundred fanatics, heavily armed, rather like dissident Catholics taking over the Vatican with heavy weapons. And it took the Saudi Arabian army, this is the most sacred site in the Muslim world, took the Saudi Arabian army 3 weeks and 600 casualties to get them out. There were urban uprisings in cities like Hama in Syria, led by the Muslim Brotherhood, that one. Syrian army went in, isolated the middle of the city, and then killed everybody in the middle of the city, men, women, children, old people, doesn't matter. Kill them all, let God sort them out. Civil war in Algeria lasted right through the 90s, between the military regime and the Islamists, but of course the people caught between in the villages, the people got killed all the time. 150,000 dead there alone. And at the end of all that blood and terror, not a single success. They never cracked 20% popular support, in my personal view. However much you hated the regime, you didn't believe these people had the solution. And so the regime, the revolutions never happened. Terribly discouraging if you are an Islamist. And they were a fairly discouraged crowd by the end of the 20th century. Most, you know, half the people they'd known were dead by now too. And it's at this point that bin Laden, Osama bin Laden, whose name I'm sure you're familiar with, came up with an alternative strategy. He's an Islamist. He was born, well, he's dead now, of course, but he was born in Saudi Arabia in the 50s, graduated from university in Riyadh in the 70s. He was radicalized. He became an Islamist while he was at university. He came from a very rich family, actually. His father was a billionaire in construction. Construction's Arabic for corruption. So radicalized and looking to make a revolution happen in Saudi Arabia, he quickly realized, to his great disappointment, there's never going to be a revolution here, certainly not in my lifetime, because Saudi Arabia got enormously rich in the beginning of the 1970s when the price of oil went up tenfold. And the Saudi Arabian government, not being completely stupid, realized that its future lies in making sure everybody's on the payroll. And so they put the entire population on the payroll. You know, being born Saudi Arabian was, and to a certain extent still is, winning the lottery. 60% of Saudi Arabian adults, even now, work for the government. They're difficult jobs. You've got to show up, you know, twice a month to collect the checks. But most of them don't involve much more. And so, you know, don't expect this population to rise up in wrath and overthrow the royal family. It's not going to happen, guys. So, you know, wrong nationality to be born into if you are, in fact, an Islamist revolutionary. He finished university in 75, I think it was, and was kicking around in Saudi Arabia. He'd already come to the attention of the authorities, but was not, in fact, had not been arrested at that point. But already desperately disillusioned at the prospects for doing a revolution in his country. So when the Russians invaded Afghanistan in 1979, he, like about 10,000 other young Arabs, almost all of them Islamists, volunteered, went off to fight the infidel army, the Russian army, that had invaded a Muslim country. And I think a lot of what drove them was frustration with trying to do what they'd come to do in their own countries. Here we get brownie points, and it's exciting, and we're fighting the sacred cause in another place, in another way. And they became involved with the Afghan resistance, which of course had grown already, but they were from outside, they had money, they had access to better weapons, and they were rather more sophisticated than your average Afghan villager. And so over the 10 years of the struggle against the Soviet invaders, which was horrible, there was a million Afghans killed and about 6 or 7 million refugees outside the country in Pakistan and Iran. Over that 10 years, the Afghans fighting the Russians are heavily influenced by the presence of these very impressive young Arab Islamists who come all this way to fight for us and know the Quran a lot better than we do, and you know, they're bringing us wisdom from abroad. So actually the Afghan resistance movement becomes increasingly Islamist, and in fact that's where we get the Taliban from, eventually. After 10 years, the Russians go home. Everybody goes home after a while. And in post-colonial Africa, Asia, Latin America, Western armies go in from time to time, and from this, in this perspective, the Soviet army was kind of a Western army. I mean, it's part of Europe. And they fight for a while. They never lose battles because they've got heavy weapons coming out of their ears, but they do suffer a steady drain of casualties. And in the end, people back home say, enough of this, bring the soldiers home. It's not worth the casualties to stay there. You know, like the Americans left Vietnam. You know, they never lost a battle in Vietnam, but they ended up with 55,000 dead soldiers. And at that point, the parents of America said, enough, bring the soldiers home. I don't want my kid to be the last kid dies in Vietnam. And even if we all go home, I don't think the Vietnamese are going to follow us home and invade California. So let's get out of here. And exactly the same thing happened to the Russians in Afghanistan. 10 years, 14,000 Russian dead, and Gorbachev comes to power in 1986, and the demand by then for Russian parents, get our kids out of there, is mounting rapidly, and in 89 he pulls them all out, leaving Afghanistan to its own devices. So who is going to come to power in Afghanistan? And the answer is, of course, the Islamists. They led the resistance. The Russians went. I guess we drove them out. Hurrah! Who's going to run the place? Well, they've got the guns and they're also the heroes. So on two counts, they are the likeliest people to inherit power, which of course with the Taliban, they did. Now, the Arabs who have been there for 10 years are not going to be part of the Taliban government. Raw nationality, you don't even speak the local language very well. And they can't go home because by now they're all wanted men back home in the Arab world. And so they're hanging around in Afghanistan trying to figure out what to do next, and it's all very clear already that the Islamist uprisings aren't going to happen in the Arab world, that this strategy is not bringing us to power. They initially expected almost an instant victory, as people do in these things. And it's bin Laden who has the big new idea. Same ideology, of course, and the same goals, of course. But the path now that he thinks might work is, if you lead a resistance movement in a Muslim country to a foreign invasion, you do get power when they go home, as they always do. That is the message of the war we just fought in Afghanistan. Nothing else is working. Why don't we try that? And in about 91 or 92, as well as you can track the discussions among bin Laden and his merry men in the camps of southern Afghanistan, this idea takes root. And I think he has legitimate claim to have seen the potential in this alternative approach. We're not trying to make a revolution anymore. We can't get them off their asses. They just don't buy into the idea. But if a foreign army invades and we lead the resistance and we win and they go home, we get power. So he begin, and who are we going to get to invade next time? You're not going to sucker the Russians into doing this twice. So who else have we got? And the answer is, of course, the United States. The only other power, infidel power, with the military reach and the financial resources to send an army all the way to the Middle East. So how do we provoke the Americans into doing that? And he begins attacking American targets in the Middle East and Africa in the 90s, because after all, he doesn't have much in the way of resources. A few hundred men, not much money, no heavy weapons. So truck bombs outside American embassies in Kenya and Tanzania, big truck bombs, they killed and wounded about 4,000 people. But how many of those were Americans? 12. 12 dead. Bill Clinton didn't bother invading any Arab country over that. He just sent some cruise missiles and sprinkled them over the camps in southern Afghanistan, job done. And so then they attack an American warship in an Arab port in Aden, about 96 or 7, I think it was. Blew a hole in the side of it, killed 17 American sailors. Again, not enough. You can't get the Americans to invade over 17 dead, particularly if they're not seen, they're not on television, they're in the ship and foreign parts. So a few more cruise missiles, crews sprinkled on the camps, and that's that. The idea of attacking America directly on home soil and with a mass casualty attack probably did not occur to him until 97 or 98. And the planning probably didn't begin until 99. So it took 2 years to plan. It was a very complicated attack. 20 people directly involved would infiltrate them all into the States. It would only work at number of foreigners coming in, four of them taking flying lessons in the United States and provoking one FBI office in Omaha, I think it was, to report that there's a bunch of ARABs here. They're learning to fly, but they seem curiously uninterested in learning how to land. There was a report to that effect. But, it didn't occur to anybody that there might be such an attack, so it got, stuff to it. It wasn't a plot or anything, it didn't get acted on, because, so what? That's peculiar, but, what does that tell us? Nothing. And so the attacks go in September of 2001, and kill 3,000 people, and they do it on live television. By the end of the afternoon, when the Twin Towers collapsed, 80% of the American public was watching it live. The impact of that on the U.S. public was overwhelming. Any government, any American administration, after that, was going to have to invade some Muslim country. I mean, which one doesn't much matter, because Americans aren't good at geography, even though they fight wars and it is God's way of teaching Americans geography. Nevertheless, fine distinctions like, Morocco or Yemen, don't arise much in the average American's mind, but kick some ass, punish somebody. We need action here, and frankly, the Al Gore won in the 2000 election. Well, he did, sort of. He would have had to invade. It wasn't optional. And you get the invasion, first of all, of Afghanistan, which is not exactly what bin Laden had in mind, because after all, he's an Arab, and they've already got an Islamist government, so this is not actually produced, but he couldn't do it from anywhere else. He was a wanted man, he had to do it from there, the Americans, he was there. You know, it's a start, we'll see where it goes from here. And boy, did it go from there, because 16 months after Afghanistan, Mr. Bush invaded Iraq. Yeah. What was he thinking? There were no Islamists in Iraq. Saddam Hussein killed them all. And at first they were trying to kill him. It had nothing to do with terrorism. Didn't have any weapons of mass destruction either, but you know. Never mind why some mysteries will not be given to us to understand. But he did it, and of course, when he did it, all the Islamist revolutionaries in the Arab world throw off their frustrations and flock to Iraq to lead the resistance against the American invaders. The resistance in Iraq starts in 2 weeks. And it's led by people from all over the Arab world, Islamists. The organization they create in Iraq is called, initially, Al-Qaeda in Iraq, after bin Laden's organization, Al-Qaeda. They fight the Americans for 8 years in Iraq before the Americans finally go home in 2011, inflicting about 4,500 dead casualties, at least four or five times that many seriously wounded. As battlefield medicine gets better, the ratio of wounded who survive to the dead goes up very high, but they're very badly injured people. And the Americans go home and they build some more. And in 2010, they changed their name to Islamic State in Iraq. And 2012, after they've expanded into Syria next door, which is now undergoing a civil war, they become Islamic State in Iraq and Syria, ISIS. And in 2014, they put together all of their holdings in Iraq and their new holdings in Syria. Eastern half of Syria, western half of Iraq, but join them, and Islamic State becomes an actual country. 5 million people, two big cities, government, an army, a budget, oil, the whole thing. Not bad going for a handful of people with no money or heavy weapons. And that's who we're up against. Not a monster, and it didn't appear from nowhere. It is the same organization. The people who are leading Islamic State today were the people, most of them, the leading people, were people who went to Iraq in 2003 to fight the American invasion. There's complete continuity. These are very experienced people by now. And so eventually we're dragged back into the conflict after they overrun an awful lot of territory in Syria and Iraq, and there's even 1,000 Canadian soldiers out there, not in combat, but training the Kurds to fight the Islamic State in northern Iraq. And Americans are bombing all over the place. We were doing some bombing too. Russians are there bombing as well now. How are we to make of all this? Well, the first thing to make of it is, even after all the excesses they've had, it's still a very small threat. They're not even going to take over all of Syria or all of Iraq. There was a moment about a year ago when they were close to taking over Syria because the Syrian regime's army was tottering. And that's when the Russians went in September last year. And they basically solved the problem with Syria. They restored the morale of the Syrian army, and now it is extremely unlikely, verging on impossible, for the Islamic State to imagine that one day they will rule all of Syria, which would actually make them a more serious player on the chessboard. They're not going to overrun the rest of the Arab world, they're not going to overrun the rest of the Muslim world, and they certainly aren't going to overrun the rest of the world. I mean, Big Ideas is commonplace, among radical groups of every sort. You know, one day we will rule the world after the war. You've had a hot dinner for every group of movement that has said that, you'd actually get a lot of weight put on. But they're not a great threat. And in fact, I think they're a dwindling threat, even in the Middle East, to their neighbors. They managed to make more progress with this strategy than had been made with the previous one, but it also has a sort of limited shelf life, and I think it's run out. So what happens next is quite probably, particularly given that Mr. Trump is liable to make a deal with the Russians to stamp out Islamic State and restore the Assad regime to power over all of Syria, which will be a pretty bloody business. But it will eliminate Islamic State as a country. The people who have the ideology, those who survive the collapse of the Islamic State, I'm assuming it does over about the next 18 months to 2 years, will still be Islamists, they will still be revolutionaries, they will still be willing to use terrorism, so terrorism will not vanish. The war against terrorism, I hate the phrase, but the war against terrorism is like the war against crime, which is often declared by various politicians. And you know in your heart that when a politician promises you a war on crime, he's not really promising that all the criminals will one day be arrested, come out with their hands up, and then there will be no more crime. He's just saying we'll get the crime rate down. And I think you have to view a war on terrorism in exactly the same way. The only thing you're going to accomplish is to get the terrorism rate down, and we've done that. It's really very low. You have a much greater risk of drowning in the bathtub than you do of being killed by terrorists. So do be careful of the soap. And how will it all end? I think it will all end with them aging out. They're not going to change their minds after these decades of struggle and sacrifice, but they're getting older and they're not as attractive to the younger generation. I mean, they're still recruits, of course. World is full of 18-year-old males. They'll join anything that looks exciting. Gives them a role in the world. But most of them go off after a couple of years, and if it's dad's ideology, they're less attractive in the first place. So, you know, eventually ideologies, revolutionary ideologies in particular, die out with the people who held them. They don't get transmitted unchanged. Look at not to compare them, but consider what happened to the separatist movement in Quebec. It aged out, basically. And I'm not calling the separatists terrorists at all, but I'm just saying big ideas like that have a shelf life. And it's basically tied to the generation that fell for them. So yeah, eventually it will die down, but we'll have other problems to worry about. In fact, we already do. So here is where, with an enormous grinding of gears, I move on from terrorism to, I guess you'd call it Trumpism. I think you have to admit that the Brexit vote in June in Britain, leaving the European Union and inflicting serious damage upon the European Union, followed by an election in the United States that delivers a man like Trump, and I need not go into his multifarious defects,